Coolness. Welcome along, everyone. You're here for a session on testing Windows Store applications with Visual Studio 2012. We know Windows Store applications, because if you're not into Windows Store applications, you're not going to have a great session, is my guess. So straight up, Windows Store applications. The old thing we used to maybe call Metro just briefly, but we don't anymore. That's bad and evil. It also talks about Visual Studio 2012, and that will be probably half of the session. What I want to do is, there's some things missing in 2012, things that weren't quite ready yet. So what I want to do is to show you how some of those have been resolved for us in 2013. So it will really be around both versions of the product, not just exclusively 2012 as per the session title. Okay? It's one of those things you're really supposed to stay very close to the title, and I always try to, but I think I'd do a disservice not to show you something missing out of 2012. And then the good news, here it is in 2013. So I think that justifies a little change there. So my name's Anthony Boughton. Hey, go clicker. Power on the side. Look at that, that's amazing. My name's Anthony Boughton. I'm a Microsoft Visual Studio ALM MVP. This is my eighth year now, I think. I'm a Microsoft Certified Trainer and a Microsoft Certified Professional. So it was interesting, with the 20th anniversary of TechEd, this is also the 20th anniversary of my first Microsoft exam. That seems such a long time ago. What was the exam code? It was exam 001, their very first exam. It was MS-DOS 5 and microcomputer hardware. And it was a prerequisite to be certified in Word 2. Because knowing the registers of the CPU and some obscure command line switches from the DOS prompt really helps that word processing. I thought it was a great idea. But anyway, and then I think, what was the other one they did? Ah, Windows for Workgroups. So that was the top first three exams I did back in 93. Apart from that, I'm also a Visual Studio ALM Ranger. I spend a bunch of time with the product group in Seattle. I flew back from the US on Saturday. My most recent little task has been the start screen videos. So you'll probably see a couple of those little videos when you start Visual Studio 2013. Compliments of yours truly. So nice little Australian accent there for 2013. So the agenda, what I want to talk about here this afternoon, is we're going to talk about Windows Store applications, and they're a bit different from a tester's perspective. I want to go in there and show you how we can manual test Windows Store applications. We don't have to be technical. What is the single most common form of testing done today? And I'll give you a hint, it's about 70% of all testing. That's just manual testing. So even though it's not overly complex, I'll show you a few things you can do to allow you to manually test Windows Store applications. The second part is we'll move on and look at Microsoft Test Manager. So MTM 2012, how we can do on-device testing. The third part is we're going to have a look at automated testing with Windows 8.1 and Visual Studio 2013, okay? Because that brings some things to the table that we, you know, would love to have seen in the 2012 release, but it didn't quite make it. And even with what's going to be the RTM of 2013, there's still just a few things that just aren't going to slip in there. The good news with the new shipping cadence is that we expect update one, probably around 3 months after the release of 2013, and update one is this great opportunity just to slot those things back in that didn't quite make it. So that release shipping cadence, increased frequency of that shipping cadence is really good news for us. All right, so Windows Store applications are different. Who's written a Windows Store app? Excellent. Who's tested a Windows Store app? Well, who's used a Windows Store app? Isn't it the same thing? Yeah, of course it is. But it is very different. Or is it very different? What are the things we need to be aware of when we move forward into a Windows Store application? Hey, I guess that's the black button, isn't it? Cool. Go away, black. Hey, look, it's a toggle. This is excellent. It's made for presenters. And that's the right button. So guys, there's a bit of text up there. That's not great from a presenter's perspective, but really handy if you grab the slides and look at the presentation after Tech Ed. So basically what it says up there is it talks about it's a new type of application. It's specifically around the Windows 8 immersive experience. Unlike traditional applications, your Windows 8 apps have this sort of Chrome-less experience. And what I mean by Chrome-less, the borders around the outside. The window, which is interesting, it's a windowless Windows application. By default, it's going to fill the entire screen. But that does change with the Windows Snap capability. And of course, in 8.1, that's going to change a lot more. So a lot more flexibility and freedom in how you snap these applications. And that's going to be a big thing for testing. Okay, full screen's all well and good, but of course, if we can change the screen size, if we can snap it to a third of the screen or lots of other choices now, we need to make sure that our app's going to redraw correctly. Testers need to test and ensure that for us. A Windows Store app can also support different layouts. It's around, well, this is, I think I had a marketing moment here. You ready? Fluid and harmonious experience across a variety of form factors. Marketing would be proud, I'm sure. And then Windows Store apps are designed to run on Windows 8X. There's a lot of experience, most of these applications are heavily focused on that touch experience. Okay, our friendly AV guy up the back here, who does a great job, will recount for you, I'm sure, with a smile, that I've just put fingerprints all over his laptop. Because everything I do now has touch. Even my Kindle, you know, the old Kindle with the little buttons on the side, I just got sick of touching the screen, it was embarrassing. So had to get a Kindle Touch, had to upgrade it. I can justify anything really when it's electrical and shiny. Your testing experience needs to include things now like the app bar. It needs to talk about our tiles. We need to think about gestures, swipes. We need to think about pinching and how that's going to work with the application. We need to integrate with the charms. So app capabilities built into the platform that we want to be able to work with. Let's have a quick look at a Windows Store application. Okay, so magically I'm going to switch to number 2. Isn't that great? You taught me well. So, IE. Oh, that's not the one I wanted. Go away. So here we go. Let's swipe up from the bottom, get rid of that, pop down the bottom here. Jump into Bing, do that. Okay, so this is IE. Initially, I wasn't a big fan of the two IEs. I don't know that I really like two IEs still. You know, one is the desktop experience, one is the Windows 8 experience. Okay, would you agree? Have you had any frustration about having two different ones with different behaviors? It's a quiet audience. You guys have a really big lunch today. Yeah? All right, I must have missed out on that. So look at this application. There's no window around the side. Up the top there, there's no minimize, there's no maximize. That entire application is available to the developer. You can control that entire experience. So if I want to go in and change some things about it with a bit of touch, we swipe up from the bottom. I can go in here and say, I want to add an extra tab. As opposed to that little tab across the top with the little character, I can't remember what it is, that you click to get a new tab. So I guess that's often where the frustration comes from. It's just the different experience. But if you were thinking about this, certainly on a handheld device, a little swipe from the bottom or a swipe from the top where your hands natively rest makes perfect sense. So you want to make sure that these things work. If I go in there and choose, we'll go and visit the guys at Mountain Goat Software. So often when I'm training agile courses, teaching people how to implement Scrum with TFS, we go and talk about, you know, planning poker and the cards and things, and there's a nice little site there. So I can also go in here, and we need to be able to, okay, swipe back up again, back to Bing, integration with platform features, the charms. I'm going to swipe out from the side. I can go into the Share Charm and have a look at the application, how it integrates with Share. We can go in there and we can share either through the Mail application, either through the People Hub. or if I've got a variety of other applications there, they're going to appear in the list for me. If I go in to choose a different charm, if I use the search charm, and I might type in TechEd. So did you see from the charm, it passes that back to the application that we've got working there and gives me some results. So in testing our Windows Store application, there's all those touch experiences, the gestures we've got to deal with. There's integration with charms. There's just a lot more. The reason we've got to do this is not only is it going to be potentially new to you as a tester, perhaps, it's going to be new to the end user, although they'll pick that up quite quickly, but who else is it going to be a new thing for? The developers. You know, the developers are figuring out how to go and work with this experience. They're figuring out how to integrate and work with those charms. So given that they're learning, it puts the onus back on us as testers to be able to test all those things, to make sure they're implementing it correctly. So it's pretty important stuff. All right. Let's get rid of that guy. Which is, I'm going to go back to screen number one. Okay, my voice control has some latency. Moving right along then. Sorry? Well, I know. He hasn't got much to do during a session like this. Is that fair to say? All right, manual testing Windows Store applications using web test case management. So who was in Adam's session this morning? Anyone? Adam and Damien's session? So one of the things you would have seen there is some of the web-based test case management. Did they open up the test hub? I was getting ready for an ILL. I didn't see it. But I would have expected Adam would have showed you the web-based test hub. Okay, regardless, how about I do that for you? So in manual testing an application, I want to talk about... Oh, I did it again. I'm going to have to put some tape over the black button because it scares me. There we go. So the web hub, sorry, the test hub or the web test case management first arrived in TFS 2012 update 2. Okay, who's used it? Just three hands there. So you've got to get update 2 to get the experience. It was improved, I think, incrementally in update 3 and again improved quite a lot for what will be the 2013 release. So there's some scenarios up there that are quite important. The first scenario there is where we want to be able to execute on a non-Microsoft OS, where we don't, where we're unable to go and install the Microsoft Test Manager client. Now, it is the, you know, we'll call it the rich client, and it is a richer experience. If you can put MTM, Microsoft Test Manager, onto the platform you're testing, you're going to have a richer, better experience. This is a more lightweight client. We don't have things running on that box. We just have a browser. So we don't get things like the action recording. When we go and raise bugs, we don't have all the diagnostic data adapters, the data collectors giving us rich information for when we go and create a bug. But we do get a nice, lightweight little client. That's what it is. So there's some good scenarios there where that web client's quite a valuable thing for us. So let's have a bit of a peek at that one. I've got too many computers. So I might go, should do it myself now. So let's have a look at what that experience looks like. Popping back to the desktop there, I'm going to, actually, you know what? We can do it from where we were. I'm going to pop back up here, close that, bring up my favorites, pop into here. All right, so you could access this screen many different ways. This is just the web access. If you happen to be in Visual Studio, click on web access, up comes this screen. And what we've done here is across the top, I've selected the test option. Now, this is a very recent release. The very first time that you may have had a look at the test hub, you couldn't create test plans in here. You had to create the test plan in the rich client. But I can go up here now, you'll see the test plan that I'm working on. I can go in here and I can now create my test plans directly from this client. So the client is very rich in most ways with the exception of the runtime experience when you're running your tests. I can go in here and create test suites. I can create a new test suite. in here, give it a name. Try that again, click the top one, that's a nicer thing to do. Okay, and this particular suite could be, let's say the, what's the Windows? Creativity just jumped out of the room. So I can go in here and say I want to test the Maps app. I can go and say I want to create a new test case. You will have seen this before if you've used MTM or if you've created a test case using Visual Studio. I want to be able to go and test the favorites feature in IE10. I can work my way down here and I can go and put in my test steps, open IE10. I can pop in an expected result there, IE10 opens. That's not typical. And I can work my way through that, save and close it. So creating manual test cases through that web experience is quite straightforward. What I want to do is I want to show you going and running one of these things. So I'm going to go in and say that I want to go and run this particular test case. It's going to start the test runner, but the test runner appears just as a browser window. So remember, this is what most testing is. It's manual testing. And this is, in my opinion, not technical at all. First thing it says is go and start the Maps application. That's the one we want to test. So I'm going to pop back out here, jump into the Maps application. Ooh, the net's going really quick. Must be all these technical people. Okay, what I'm going to do is just use the window snap capability just to bring that window back out with the test runner in it. Okay, so as a straightforward and quite simple experience for manual testing Windows 8 applications, what you'll see here is I've got my test runner snapped to the left-hand side of the screen, and on the rest of the screen there, you'll see my application that I wish to test. Step one says I want to go and start the application, so we'll give that a pass. Swipe up from the bottom and choose my location. Let's try that. Where is this network point coming out? Okay, that's really interesting. We're in North Sydney. Worked fine. Doesn't matter. Okay, yes, we'll give that a pass. A suspect pass, I've got to say. I'm going to then swipe out from the side. I'm really fascinated as to why they got that wrong. Search. Wow, this is going to really test it. I'm going to search for Brisbane Airport. Okay, we'll give that a pass. And I'm going to choose directions. This will be a big drive. Go. Okay. Ah, put me back on the Gold Coast. I think we need to raise a bug with Microsoft here. So, cool. So, it's going to take you an hour and 3 minutes. It hasn't really seen the traffic and the roadworks, has it? No, not at all. I would allow more if you're going back to Brisbane Airport. So the expected result there is the route should be drawn on the map. So I've tried to keep that nice and easy. I'm happy with that, so I'm going to give that a pass. And then it wants me to close the Maps application. So we'll go ahead and get rid of that. So I've gone through a manual test. Again, it's been a very, very simple test. So that shouldn't, don't let that put you off. Manual testing can be quite involved. I only had 5 steps up there. I only had a single expected result. So reasonably straightforward. If you look at the top there, I've also got the ability to choose to go and raise a bug. So of course I can go and raise a bug there. I can document all the details. So I do have a pretty good experience there, even if I don't have quite all those diagnostic adapters pulling in information from the application. Okay. But as far as an experience goes, that's pretty straightforward. Let's have a look. Can I still write? Yep, create a bug. Now, I'll just give us a bit more room here so we can see it. If we go down there, click on system. I mean, where you'd have that system information before, those details, you don't get it. There's really, you know, it's only what it could learn from running inside that browser experience. And of course, browsers are pretty locked down. Yeah. So, You know, in a crystal ball, what I'd love to see is I'd love to see when you have this test runner up, a little download link down the bottom so that potentially if you wanted to, you could download a set of adapters for multiple different types of platforms. But crystal ball, I don't know if we're ever going to see such a thing, but I think that'd be really neat. Okay, so let's go ahead and get rid of that one now. Any other questions about just manual testing with that test type? Yes, sir?
You mentioned it's a lightweight client. Does it have a lightweight price?
Does it have a lightweight price? Excellent question, which is me thinking about how to answer that. So I guess the capability there is built into the test professional product. So what they intend to do with that in 2013, I'm not quite sure. But as far as that test capability goes, I'm not aware of it changing and coming out of that test professional product SKU. So test professional, I think, is quite reasonably priced for what it offers. Yeah. I don't have any insight into that packaging. So if I had to answer it for today, it'd be premium, ultimate, and test professional would give you that capability. Whether they extend that into the 2013 release, magic crystal ball. Okay. So let's move past that one and let's go back to the house machine. Okay, that's not too bad. He's getting quicker up the back there. And now let's go to the next slide. Ah, you can't do that, can you? All right. So the next thing I want to move on to, again, any other questions there on manual testing those Windows 8 apps? Nope. Wasn't super sexy and exciting, was it? But I think that can be good too. It's just really straightforward and easy. Yes, sir? Is test professional part of TFS? No. So as far as the client SKUs go, you've got TFS sits in the background. Actually, how about I give you another analogy? It's like Outlook is to Exchange. So TFS stores the test cases. When you create a test case, it's a TFS work item type. TFS stores the results of the test run and the data for us for reporting purposes. The client we use, well, this is ironic. So normally, Microsoft Test Manager is part of Test Professional, which is the client SKU, Visual Studio Premium, Visual Studio Ultimate. This one's a licensing issue because it's web. It is clientless. So it's not really a case of technically where do we install it. It's just the licensing controlling who should have access to that. I would hope it's a TFS CAL, but that's speculation. I haven't seen any official news on that yet. I like the idea of a TFS CAL giving it to you. Do you know something I don't know?
That's just the way I do it. If you talk to TFS through the web interface.
See, there's your mistake. You're applying logic and common sense to licensing. Was there another question, sir? So I am using Windows Integrated Authentication there for that experience, so there will be some control of that, yes. And that is something that, as opposed to previous versions, when you go into the web access client, now we do have to control access to some of those features where before it was just CAL or no CAL. Now we've got to deal with CAL, no CAL, or premium CAL. It's licensing. I'm going to stay over this side of the room. All right. So the next thing is manual testing Windows Store applications using Microsoft Test Manager. Okay, so this one's a little bit more involved for us. So I'll give you the scenario. So you've seen the lightweight experience. We now want to have a richer experience. So we're going to set up a couple of different machines. What I'm going to do is wake one of these ones up, and he's back with me. It's all right. Beauty. On one machine, we have Microsoft Test Manager, so we have MTM set up, just as we would today for testing WinForm applications, web applications, and so forth. What we want to be able to do then is to test on our devices. I want to be able to pick up, and I've got cables hanging out of it, but my Windows tablet device, I want to use my gestures, my touch, my experience there with a richer experience so that when we do go and raise bugs, we get things like an action recording. It captures more information about what's going on in my Windows application. Now, the way I need to do that is on my device over here. Well, firstly, it's got to be Windows 8. That kind of stands to reason. You've got to have a Windows Store developer license. They're free, easy to get. You can have as many as you want. We want to be able to go and put the remote debugger on there, which includes the test tools adapter, and, of course, the application you're going to test. So let's see how we go about setting that guy up. Okay, before you begin, a couple of things to think about. Firstly, you've got to be using the same user account, although you now can choose not to have any authentication there. Setting up remote debugging tools on a device with no authentication isn't always great if you don't trust your network too much, but you could do it if you wanted to. By default, it's 6905. Okay, it just rolls off the tongue, 6905. So you've got to have access for that port to move between the device and the MTM machine. The Windows Store developer license. So you can basically get these things for free. They are bound to a single machine, and they are bound, they're also time limited. So that said, all you need to do is you can have as many as you like. They're free. When they're about to expire, you can say, I want another one. So they're not an impediment, but just something you do need to remember. And it will pop up and ask you, and you just answer it along the way. Okay, so don't be too concerned by that requirement. So the steps, install the remote debugging tools. Connect the remote device from Microsoft Test Manager, and then execute our test cases. Yes, sir, question.
What kind of app is the remote
debugger? What kind of app? How about I download it, install it, and show you?
On an IT?
So you can get x86, x64, or ARM, yes.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay. And I was intended to use the RT device, but the machine I'm using with MTM is a domain join machine, and of course I can't domain join the RT device, so I'm using a pro. But either way, yes. Interesting, actually. That said, if I was just using a Microsoft account on both devices, that shouldn't be a problem at all. It's just that my machine I'm using for demos is a domain join machine. Okay. So you go and download the tools, freely available, and as you see there, you simply choose the one that's appropriate for you. I'm going to venture over here. If I get a licensing question, I'm going back. So you choose the appropriate client you want to download. The ARM one's, I think, 15 meg, nice and small. The other two are around about the 40 meg, so reasonably trivial to download. You'll go ahead and download those and install them, and then on your Windows device, you're going to see those two particular icons. You get those guys running, and that means your device is now ready for you to start that interactive testing session. Okay? Oh, the black button. I'm going to have to use my own clicker in a minute. Configuring MTM. So I'm going to demonstrate these things to you, but again, I like to include them there for, you know, those screenshots for when you download the slides or the presentation after the event. So what you do is you go into MTM and you're going to go and point to the device that you want to use. So reasonably straightforward. And then when you want to run the tests, what happens is that you use the device, and then over on the MTM screen, that's where the test steps are. When you go and create a bug, it will screen capture what's on the device. The action recording comes from the device. So it's really the combination of those two machines that gives you the experience you're really looking for. You'll see here that when we go and raise a bug, it records information about where the test will run, in this particular case, my Surface, and the operating system, Windows 8 here. But that'll be Windows 8, Windows 8.1, whichever one you're going to use. Okay, it shows you we've got a failed step there, the screenshot has been taken, and our action recordings are a little bit different. If you've opened up an action recording using MTM in the past, that action recording simply shows you the text about what you've done. Yeah, in a usually open it up in the HTML version so you see it in a nice table. What it looks like in this experience is it's all graphical. So here's a step over here. It shows us exactly what we were doing. So of course, because we're now moving and swiping and touching, having that graphical record of the repro steps is very important. So this makes that really quite easy. One little gotcha there, and that's a gotcha I'm going to solve before we finish today. The gotcha is no automated playback. And that's neither test case fast forward, which we could do today, or coded UI test. So Windows 8 and 2012 don't let you do those two things. So let's give it a go. Let's see if we can make this work. So one of the first things we're going to do is switch across to this one. All right. So now you're looking at a tablet. That's just Mr. Surface in all its glory. Go back to my desktop. And what I've chosen to do is I've actually uninstalled those things. I want to show you the, you know, soup to nuts, the end-to-end experience. I won't worry about re-downloading it. I think that's not, you know, of questionable value to an audience. So I'm going to go ahead and let's just say we've downloaded the remote tools, the x64 package in my case with the Surface. If it was the RT, it'd just be the ARM package. The install experience is the same. Double click. Of course we agree to everything you want. Install. Yes. This is a pretty good installation experience in that it's, well, virtually done. So this is happening on my Windows 8 device. Okay. Really not much more needed to be done there. I was tempted to switch back to the other machine, but you won't trust me. You'll think that it's smoke and mirrors, won't you? And the install's done. I'll go ahead and close that. Jump back here, and let's see what it's done. Okay, remote debugger and my test tools adapter. I'll go ahead and run that. Switch back to the other one. Bring it up on the screen so we can see it. Okay. So what this is showing us is we've now installed the tools we need on that Windows 8 device. Okay, at the moment it's sitting there. Interestingly, it's gone with port 4016, which isn't really its default. Not quite sure what it's doing there to have some fun with me, but I spotted it. So any questions about setting up the device side? That's pretty straightforward. Good. So now let's go back over to here. Yes. Okay, so they install together. Go and jump back out of this runner, back to my desktop. What I'm going to do this time is we're going to go into MTM. Okay, so what I've got here is I've got a simple test plan, just like any other test plan. There's nothing Windows 8 or WinStore app specific about what you see here. I'm going to go and have a look at testing a maps application. Is, you know, test the favorites feature, test my location. Let's open that one up. So that's the experience. That's the test that you saw me do using the lightweight runner. So let's have a look at how that varies now using the rich experience. So I'm going to switch across to test. And by default, most people probably may not even look at this. It says that we're going to be running on the local machine. I'm going to change that. And I'm going to say, well, no, I want to run on a remote device. Okay, my remote device, if I look back on the other screen, you don't need to see that. It's AB-Surf Pro 4016. AB-Surf Pro 4016. That looks right. That should then... Interesting. So, slightly concerning. Okay, just pop back over there. Okay, so in this particular case, my RT's AB Surface, so that was what the screenshots were, but well spotted. So this one is definitely AB Surf Pro 4016, but that's okay. If it's a name resolution thing, we've got the technology. Okay. Back here. 1044-4136. slightly more concerning. That'd be it. That's going to slow me down. Okay, guys, Okay, there's no easy explanation for why that's the case. So the little electrons aren't going to run across these cables nice for me. I do feel better, though, that if they can't get it right in the keynote yesterday, I'm allowed to have a demo failure as well. Sorry, guys. So what that experience would have looked like is, and the frustration is this worked during rehearsal. It worked in the hotel room last night. So something about that network that doesn't want those two things talking to each other. What would have happened there for us is I would have clicked test. It would have then gone and connected to that client running on the device. I would have opened up the test runner. But where the test runner normally docks to the left-hand side of the screen, it would have gone full screen. Because we don't need any real estate to actually see the application under test. That's happening on the device. So on my MTM screen, I would have seen the steps I needed to do. And it would have said, start the Maps application. On the device, I would have simply started the Maps application. I would have swiped to the left, swiped to the right, just to show that to you. I would have then pressed the Maps application. On my MTM screen, I would have said, pass. It would have said, do the next thing. And on the device, I would have just gone through the steps. I was going to choose then to go and deliberately create a bug. And then when I raised that bug, you would have seen that now we do get the rich collectors working for us. You would have seen that it would have captured the screen of what was on that Surface device. We would have then seen the environment information, the system information, and we're back to that really rich experience again. Yes, sir?
Would it have captured the gesture or what you actually did?
Yes. So in that little screenshot there, it would have, you know, it shows the text, you know, swipe from the right, swipe from the left. It shows the screen segment. It shows where you actually push down. So the graphic representation of that's pretty good. Remember, one of the caveats, one of the gotchas today is that you don't get the test case fast forward. So if you were doing that today with a Windows form or a web app, you can then highlight half a dozen steps and say play. You don't get that. But nonetheless, that's still a very rich experience there. So, look, I'm really sorry I can't show you that. I could debug network problems for the next 20 minutes and just frustrate everyone, so please accept my apologies for that one. All right. Any other questions about that rich experience with MTM and the device? So, question. No, it will not automatically pass a test. So what I would have meant to say there is if it had have said start the map application, I would have on my device clicked the map application and it would have opened. I would have then marked the step as pass, as I would have done today. It's still a manual test, yeah? Any other questions? I'm really, really regretting actually having uninstalled all that configuration, but uninstalling it and reinstalling it, you saw what it was. It's really hard to have done it any differently or to have got that wrong. So that's just a wee bit frustrating because it really is easy and I didn't show you that experience. Yes.
Is that what it's going to record?
Absolutely, yes. So what you would have seen, and I'm really kind of glad the slides are there now since I couldn't show it to you in real time, that's what the action recording looks like. You go up there and it shows you your steps down the left-hand side. On that side of the room, the very top one up there, start the application. That was what I was told to do. What did I actually do in the application? What I did in the application was... Right mouse. Oh, come on. This is the only one I haven't got a mouse set up for. There it is. What I actually did was I pressed the Windows key. I then went and panned right, so it showed where I actually clicked to do the panning. I then went and tapped on that particular button, and then I completed that step. So that's, you know, it's a graphical rendering of the exact steps that I did for this test case, and it shows the little graphic screen images there and what was on the screen at the time. Okay, so would have been nice to show you that in real time. So I want to move on then. So you've seen that we can do manual testing. You've seen we can use a lightweight client. We can go and use a rich client 9 times out of 10. There is no automation story there. So with 2012 and Windows Store 8.0 apps, that's pretty much what you've got as far as using MTM. When you move into 8.1, when you then look at the 2013 suite, that's when things get a whole lot more exciting in terms of the automated experience. It's, you know, in the release version, it's still not going to be as smooth and rich as what we've got there with WinForm apps and web apps, but I think they've done pretty well there. So what you need to do this, and you can do it today, is with the preview versions of Windows 8.1 and the preview versions of Visual Studio 2013 that have been available since build, you can do this today. The feature, the capability, is in premium and ultimate SKUs. Okay, and then you use a bit of C# VB to do this, more so than today. Okay, so it's still going to be more of a coding experience than a record and playback, which is something you can do with most application types. So what's new in there? So there's a new project template. So that new project template is going to be coded UI. It's going to be an automated experience for Windows Store applications. There are some new specialized classes. You'll recognize them all. They start with XAML. So there's now classes representing everything you need for your Windows Store applications, including your shell controls, things like your charms that come out from the side. There's also support for touch gestures. That's a really interesting thing. We're going to use the AdventureWorks Windows Store application, and how about we jump in there and have a look at it? Okay, over to this screen. Into here. Okay, so what you're looking at there is the freely available preview version of Windows 8.1. What I'm going to do there is go in and start Visual Studio 2013 Preview Edition. Let's give ourselves a little bit of space there. Like all good demos, we start with File, New, Project. And we want to create a new test project. Let's choose C#. We go into Test and... Which one do you choose? Coded UI test project? No. They hid it, in my opinion. So let's go back over to Windows Store and go down here and choose Coded UI Test Project. Yeah, I don't know if I'm a big fan of it, but it's where it is nonetheless. So you may have missed it. I guess if you're creating Windows Store applications, you know to go to Windows Store as a folder there. I'm the kind of guy that thinks I want a Coded UI Test. It's a test project. Look in the test box. Anyway, I've made a significant point of that now, so hopefully you won't forget that one. So I'm going to choose a Windows Store application. I'm going to go down to Coded UI Test Project, and I'll go and say OK. Now, who's created a Coded UI today? Ooh, not too many hands. OK, just a couple. So if you created a Coded UI project today, that screen would look similar, but would have two very different options there. The first option you'd normally see is that I want to create the coded UI from an action recording. So if you did a manual recording of a test, you could then go in there and say, go and create coded UI, and it would write the code for you. That would be the second one. The first one would be I want to record my steps with the coded UI test builder. So edit the UI map and manually edit the test. So for the release version of this, you don't have those, you know, quite the same experience we've had before. I'll go ahead and say okay. What that's going to do is it's going to bring up the builder. Now, the builder will probably be familiar to anyone that's created it before. So that builder appears in the bottom right-hand corner. It's then automatically taken us back to my Windows 8 desktop because that's where your Windows Store app's going to live. What I can then do is I want to go and choose the objects I'm interacting with. And I can do this in a variety of different ways. I'm going to grab the crosshair here. Picking up that crosshair, let's go and find AdventureWorks and let go. So what you see there is it's gone and learnt about that particular control. If we have a look, there's a few things there of interest to us. Firstly, that automation ID. Guys, that's very, very small for you to see, but not that interesting anyway. But it's adventureworks.shopper.c#_, and then it's probably about 20 random alphanumeric characters. So that's actually built from the app manifest. So when you create a Windows Store application, information is taken from the certificate. So no matter how many times you redeploy the same application, that will remain the same. Now, when we want to go and write the code to launch the application, that's the little piece of text that we need to remember. Remember, it's not quite the same smooth experience with coded UI today, but it's not bad. So I can learn a little bit more about it. I've got my friendly name property there, the AdventureWorks application. So do I want to interact with that particular control? And if I do, I can go and add it to the UI map. Okay. So now the UI map contains all the information about being able to go and get that particular control. I'm just going to leave there for a moment, pop back to my desktop, and it is good. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and start the application.
Sorry, Anthony.
Question.
Because it's done by the ID, if that tile moves, it can still find it?
Oh, absolutely, yes. So as I'll show you the searcher properties later. So that automation ID does not change. So we're not looking at it by position, we're looking at it by that ID, which will be the same every time you deploy that same application anywhere.
Yep.
Okay, that's very, very, very unlikely to change. If, however, it did, you'd break it. Okay, so the next thing I want to do is I want to build up the UI map with objects that I want to interact with. So, for example, if I want to start by going into today's deals, you saw me drag and drop the crosshair. I can also use Control-I and say I want whatever this thing is. Now, Control-I will go and learn about what is under the mouse pointer. It does not add it to the control map yet, the UI map, but it shows me information over there. There are some subtleties. For example, see the check marks down the bottom here? The ones at the top are darker than the ones down the bottom. It's just a little visual cue, not obvious, not supposed to be obvious. So this is simply an inspect mode to have a look at it. If this is the object that I want to interact with, then I can simply hit the first button down here, and that will add it to the UI map for me. The other choice I've got, so Control-I is to inspect the thing under the mouse cursor. Control-Shift-I will actually then just automatically add it. So if I want to go and choose whatever this button is, Control-Shift-I. So it's found the search button and automatically added that to the UI map for me. I can go in and choose this guy here. I want to go and add the Add to Cart button. I want to go to the Back button, Control-Shift-I, and add that to the UI map. So while I'm doing this, I'm basically choosing any controller object that I want to either interact with, you know, a click, a gesture, a pinch, or whatever you want to do. And then I can also create some assertions here. So maybe I want to add an assertion to, what do I want to pick? Add to cart's already there. Today's deal search button. Let's add an assertion there. I just want to check the text on that. Okay, and I'll say okay. And when I'm ready, I can go ahead and write the code out. In this particular case, I've added an assertion, so it wants a method name from me. If I didn't add an assertion, I would have not had to have specified anything. It would just go and create the UI map that I need. So what I'm going to do here is call it check bike text, And of course, you can't have spaces in method names. What was I thinking? And add and generate. I'll go ahead and close the builder. And let's look at the code that's written for me. If I go and have a look at the UI map, so the UI map contains details of all of the things that I've said I wanted to interact with. I can go and find my back button. I can right-click on the back button, and I can copy the reference to the clipboard. That's quite helpful when I'm writing the code a little bit later. How do we go about finding that object? Now, I said I'd show you the searcher properties. So the way that, and it's always the find that's hard. Once we have the object, then interacting with it, clicking on it, putting some text in there, well, that's easy. If anything's going to fail, it's going to be a failure to find the object to interact with. So let's have a look at the searcher properties. And this is how we find it. The most significant thing there is that automation ID. So we look for automation ID. It's got to be a XAML control there. The control type's a button. And it tells us the particular technology. So that's what it's going to use to go and find the control for me. So long as those things don't change, I'm going to be able to reliably get back there. If they pick it up, if they move it, if they change the colour of it, we just don't care. So those tests, we want to try and make them as robust as possible. We don't want them falling over every time a developer touches the application. Yes, sir?
So that means only some applications can be tested, not
HTML5
or JavaScript
applications. Okay, so as far as RTM goes, the only types of applications that it will support will be your XAML applications, so it won't do WinJS stuff yet. Okay. Did you say good?
Yes.
Anyone out there writing WinJS that doesn't like this guy anymore? Good. So I think the WinJS is on the backlog. I think you'll find it. It could, I don't know, it might sneak into the RTM. My guess is it's probably going to be an update one or two. All right, so let's go ahead and jump out of there. So we can go and look at the UI map there. I can go and have a look at the method that exists over here. So that's where I went in there and did my assertion. I can go and make changes over here, as you can with the UI map today. I'm going to, rather than go and write all of that code for you, which is really uneventful and unexciting, let's get out of here. And I'm going to take you across to an application in AdventureWorks. We'll open up AdventureWorks, C Sharp. Let's grab that solution, say yes. Don't know why I said yes there. Okay, over to my Solution Explorer, into tests, coded UI tests. So there's a UI map here already, and my coded UI test. So if we go in here, there's some interesting controls. So firstly, your HTML controls, they're not new, but if we happened in our Windows application to host an HTML control that did some rendering inside it, we're able to find controls in there without any problem at all. Things like there, that particular Windows runtime controls, that's where all the new XAML objects are that we need and rely upon for this testing. And then directly above that are the direct UI controls. So if I was to pull out my charms on the side, those charms are not XAML controls. So it's through the using there for direct UI controls that we're able to go in there and interact with things like search, share, and so forth. Yes, sir, question?
Will it test third-party XAML controls that you've bought and don't have the source for?
Will it test third-party XAML controls that you've bought and don't have the source for? Yes. The big question there, though, is have they used the accessibility controls to reliably let us find them? Now, almost all of the major vendors have been doing, you know, doing these things for a while now. It's when Coded UI was first available in 2010. You, with third-party controls, you were just in a world of hurt. And we're talking about vendors, you know, the Infragistics, the DevExpress, the Telerik controls. So that first generation there for, in my opinion, probably the first year wasn't a lot of fun. But those vendors over time have been putting the appropriate things in there to make those controls testable. So I would probably expect any reputable vendor today to be putting in the things that we need. So I'd like to believe the answer is it is going to be a yes for you. Okay? I can't give you a better answer than that. Okay, so popping back here. So some of the new things that are in here. This is the first test that I'm going to show you. I'm just going to shrink this down so we can see it. I didn't get zoom it into this VM. All right, I should have thought of that first. Hey, cool. So I had that little crutch, and that little crutch was just zoom it, and I used zoom it for everything. This is awesome, dude, thank you. I don't like WinJS either. We're on the same we're on the same team. Okay, so one of the first things here is launching the application. So new classes there to start up our Windows 8 applications. To the right-hand side, and it's truncated, you don't need to see the rest of it, but remember I said we had the automation ID that we found when I hovered over the tile for the AdventureWorks application. That little string, the automation ID, that's what we put up here so that we know reliably the application to launch. So a little bit of code there gets the application up and running for us. The line above it, I'll explain after you see it run. Okay, so there's a few little funky things there in this code. But in essence, we launch the application. This is just obfuscated away a little bit just for cleanliness of the demo. All this does is it returns us back to the home page in the application if we're not already there. Okay, so that's all that one does. As we work our way down, we're going to go and do a mouse click. Okay, that's not overly exciting or interesting to us. We're going to go and have a look at what's been added to the cart. Now we're getting interesting. In order to be able to, you know, interact with these Windows applications, the big things touch. It's a human, you know, feeling the device touching the screen. So how's that going to work in a fully automated test? Do we need to go and get, you know, touch-enabled hardware in order to run these tests? And isn't one of the benefits of a fully automated test the fact you can run it as part of a build overnight? Do we need a touchscreen in our server farms? Maybe the IT pros would appreciate it, but it's not going to help run these tests. So being able to use these gesture classes here allows your code to go and click and pinch and work with that Windows application in a fully automated way. So as part of, you know, an automated build, as you can today with Windows forms and web applications, we can now fully automate overnight UI tests across Windows store applications. Get my technology right. I think that's pretty cool.
Is that from a TFS build?
That's from TFS build, yes. I mean, if you aren't using TFS build to do that, if you're using something else as an alternative, then calling out to the command line tools to still do that would be just fine. Okay, so your tcm.exe will do that. Down here, I will skip that guy for a minute as well. Down here, we do a little bit of cleanup, so we add something to the cart, we get the price of the value of what's in the cart, we make sure it's okay. Then for cleanup, we're going to go and remove the item from the cart. We then close the application. So let's see if it works. So again, all I've done there is we've gone and identified the objects we need. Remember, for Windows and WinForm, web, we could have gone in there and it would have recorded our steps. So for those few people that have created coded UI before, we don't have that. Okay, again, I've got to say it's coming, but it's really what's going to make the cut for that RTM release for 2013 is my guess. So we're back to a little bit more coding. Let's see if it works. Right click, run the test. Not as interesting standing here watching it, but thinking of this doing the job for us, I can't have two bad demos on one day, surely. Hey, there we go. So we're going to go and add something to the cart, or in this case, I think we're about to go home, find something in the cart, find the value of it. We're going to go and add it to the cart. We're going to check what's in there. And then we end our application. Let's see how the test went. I'll switch back over here. And it failed. Why did it fail? Because I already had one of those items in the cart. Okay, my app was still running from when I recorded it. I went and added one into the cart. We put one in there and expected that there was only going to be one in there. I can't actually recall whether or not I removed a single one or removed all of them. So just out of curiosity and interest, if I happen to empty the cart at the end of that test, the second one should work. Uh-oh. Or did I put one in and take one out? Let's find out. Oh, I'm in a world of hurt now. Or did I do none of the above? None of the above was the answer. So that test's still failing, which is good, because it shows that it's actually doing a test for me. Justified? No, I refuse to... Check out. No. Remove. I know you don't trust me. Yeah, just have one failed demo. Okay. If I run it again, I'm going to assume that's going to... You just have to see it, don't you? I just have to see it too. One failed demo, I doubt myself. Add to the cart, one item, 577.12. And now we should see that test passing. Phew. All right, credibility restored just a wee little bit there. Okay, so I've gone in there and run that test. And again, so you've seen automation over a Windows Store application with 8.1 in 2013. Any questions so far? Nope? All right. I want to show you... pop into the next test. So in terms of the way that we work with applications in Windows Store... So we were doing touch, we were doing some gestures there. What this one's designed to show us is something a little bit more interesting. I want to be able to test when we do pinch. Okay, the zooming capability. You know, these things need to be tested in the application. So I'll go ahead and what this one's going to do is there's a semantic zoom control embedded in the application. I'm going to specify the bounding rectangle around it. And I'm going to go in here and use my gesture.pinch. If we pop in here for a second, tap, double tap, flick, pinch, press and hold, slide, stretch, swipe. So the gesture class basically lets you do all of the things you could do with your hand, with an actual device there. So let's see if that one works. There we go. Let's go and run that test. So what we should see here is we're going to pinch in, and once we've done the pinch, we want to count that there are five things visible on the zoom. So we're going to go back to home. There's nothing in there. There's the pinch happening. We saw that there were five things there, and that's what that test was about. If the actual pinching was doing the job, we should have seen five. We enumerate those things, and if that test worked, which it did, we're going to get a pass there. Okay, so just another characteristic or another test. And that's where we're saying we expect to see five things visible when that pinch is occurring. The last test that we'll have a look at is this one here, so charms integration. Now, the charms integration is a little bit different on account of the fact that these aren't XAML controls. We're going to now go and use the direct UI controls to do this. So what you'll see we do up there is we go and launch the application, but we're going to use send keys to send across Windows Eye to bring the charms out. When the charms come out, we're going to do a gesture tap, and we're going to use the integration with login for the settings charms. I'm going to go and put in a username and password. I'm going to go and click login. And then we want to go and test by bringing the charms out again to see that we have, in fact, logged in. Okay, so again, another typical test. Remember, with Windows Store applications, your settings really should integrate with charms. Remember, if we swipe our charms out, we haven't actually got an app there. See settings down the bottom. So Windows Store applications, you shouldn't build your own UI for those settings. You should basically leverage the capability built in. In the same way that search and share and settings are all here for us, that's what we should be using in our Windows Store applications. So let's see if that's going to work. Again, let's give that a quick run. You should see the charms pop out a couple of times there. Okay, let's see how that one went. Okay, so that happened really quickly. So it popped out, clicked on settings, went up there, put in username and password, clicked on login, called it back out again to make sure that the text on the button was now log out to prove that we had in fact logged in. So writing those tests to interact with the ecosystem around your Windows Store applications is really straight. Well, I was going to say straightforward. I mean, those gesture classes, the XAML classes in there to represent each of the objects that you're working with, the direct UI controls for things like the charms in the side, really make that a lot easier for us. Moving forward, I'd expect to see things like the ability to do the record that we've got today. I'd love to see that come online. That's going to make the experience just a whole lot nicer. There were two things just before I start to wrap up that I remember I was going to tell you about. If we pop back up here, do this one play nicely for me. There was this line here that happened just before I went ahead and ran or launched the application. Did that play nice? Please, please, please. Why?
The name is wrong. It's demo session.
But it is a local file. Why? Okay. Not having a lot of luck with networking stuff up the front here. Okay, so let me explain what was going on there. So if I had have gone in there, I should be able to go output, I should be able to click that action log for us. I should get a really rich screen that shows me all of the things that we interacted with there. I should be able to expand any of those rows that we'd see in that action recording, and on the right-hand side, I'd see a little thumbnail showing what was on the screen when the interaction took place. I can click a thumbnail and it opens up full screen for me. So what that is, it's a full action recording with, you know, a very graphic intensive version, but I can go and click on output there and I should be able to click on that. I mean, that is a local file accessible on this particular machine and I am on the network, so something just not talking nicely on my network today. Now, because of the, you know, taking all of that screen capture as we go is reasonably expensive, the default is to turn that off. So that first line that I showed you back here overrides that value up here. And in that logger, we go and say we want the all action snapshot. That's what's telling it to take that little snapshot on every single step that we do during the action recording. It's far more impressive if you can see those little screenshots, but interesting. How about we just borrow that little bit there? I don't want to get too carried away. Pop that into there. I didn't hear that. Not even listening. Look at that. It's huge. I'm not going to go to Chrome. Open with. There's so much stuff there. Come on. Now, what's an easy? I really just want to see this in a rendered view now. Can I do that easily? But wasn't that what we were trying to do? So I can find it here, go ahead, open with. IE. I won't download another browser. So, why? Why? There's like nearly a meg and a half of great value there with all this little embedded information in it that I'm just having just a great time with our network up the front. I'll blame Mr. Laptop for that one. The other thing, and the final thing there, is there was one other line I said I was going to skip for the moment. You probably weren't noticing this as we went along, or you probably took it for granted. When I was running one of those automated tests, when I clicked an object or interacted with an object, did you see it draw a box around it on playback? So that's a diagnostic thing. So what I've done there, where I say that troubleshooting, I go and turn on the draw highlighting. Now what that does is when you interact with the object, it does the drawing and it pauses for 5 to 7 seconds, something along those lines. So that's really a diagnostic aid so that on playback you can see what's going on. Otherwise it'd happen very, very quickly. So you typically put these things in to troubleshoot UUI tests here. And then once you finish that, you want to take them out. You don't want those 5 to 7 second delays happening wherever you interact with a control. But for troubleshooting, it's quite extraordinary just to see those little boxes drawn around things that you're working with. All right, so virtually time to wrap up. Let's go back to number one. So our final gotchas there. Some current limitations. Recording of action steps and creating coded UI tests for XAML apps is not currently supported. So you can't generate this from an action recording as you can today with web forms and WinForm applications. Only XAML-based store apps are supported, so nothing there yet for WinJS. And that's just a time thing. We expect to see that one coming with probably update 1 or update 2. And the functionality that you've seen there is only 8.1 and 2013 previews. I would expect, when's 8.1 release date? October something, is it? I've announced that. End of October somewhere. I think we're going to see a release candidate of Visual Studio before then. I don't know if we're going to see the Windows platform. That would probably be a surprise. So either use the build, the versions available from build, preview today to try this out, or just be a little bit more patient till perhaps the end of October and you'll be able to use those full RTM versions of this. Some related content there. So there's some breakout sessions you might be interested in. A couple of hands-on labs there, some exploratory testing. So I don't know that there's a hands-on lab or any experience there where you will see the 2013 things yet. So I don't know that you can really experience those things. There's a session on the Absolute Beginner's Guide to Windows 8 App Development. So if that's something that you're interested in, Dev217 is probably a good choice there. Adam and Damien doing a session on climbing the agile test ladder. So that's going to show a lot of the new things around testing. I've got a talk on the cloud-based load testing coming up tomorrow afternoon. So if you wanted to have a look at that, by all means. Remember, the deck's there for downloading, so you can certainly grab that. In the showcase downstairs in the dev den, you can certainly look at a few more of these things. There is a software testing exam. It is 2012 at the moment for using MTM if that was of interest to you. And when you don't see me up here, I'll probably hang out down around the dev den. If I can ask you to please fill in your eval forms there. There's some nice little prizes there that they're giving away as an encouragement for you. And I think, how are we going? Timekeeper? Time's up! We did it! Thank you very much, guys. Enjoy the rest of your tech ed.